Thank you very much, Ian, for that kind introduction. Well, if you want to really get jealous, I am just outside Geneva, so it's a lovely area to be in. It is morning here, but I'm very grateful that we can do this online and still be able to participate in this Australian conference. So thank you for the invitation. I will be, like you said, indeed talking about Neospora infections in wild dog in Victoria. And I would like to start by acknowledging the people who actually did the most of the work. And that includes Michaela and Jose, two very talented students in my lab. Carlo Pacioni at the Arthur Raleigh Institute, who's been really instrumental behind actually most of the wild or projects on wildlife in my lab, really pushing us out of our comfort zones. And Danielle Stevens and Yvette Hitchin, who did the host genetic analysis I'm going to be talking to you about. So just as a way of introduction, dingoes are really widely distributed across Australia. They are generalist and opportunistic carnivore and country's top water predator. We just had a lovely talk about dingo controls. And it's fair to say that particularly after post-European settlements, the increased urbanisation and land use in Australia has really increased the proximity and interactions with wild dog populations between humans and wild dogs. And with that comes the potential role for the transmission of pathogens of agricultural significance and possibly of public health relevance. So this really is what sets the scene for us for the, I guess, the overarching role of the project that we're leading, and with the objective of understanding the transmission pathways between pathogens of canids around human and agricultural settings. And of course, that is, as everyone would know here, that it's this understanding is crucial for the management and control of such pathogens in wild and domestic canid populations. So over the last few decades, numerous endoparasites have been reported in the literature to infect wild dogs in Australia. And that really has implicated wild dogs as key players, potentially in the transmission cycle of endoparasitic diseases. The fact that wild dogs shared land with other sympatric species, that really creates a possible route of transmission for a sylvatic cycle between wild dogs and wild and domestic herbivores. Mm-hmm. And in Australia, this predator and prey interaction has been suggested to be involved in the transmission of a large number of parasites. And I need to read this table, but just to highlight a bit of a literature review that we've put it together with a number of parasites that have been identified in wild dogs in Australia, in Victoria, New South Wales, in Queensland, and particularly to point out at a paper that came out in 2010 where an experimental infection of wild dogs had been made with Neospora caninum, and really that created I guess the last piece of evidence that we have, but only one of the few pieces of evidence that we have, that these parasites can infect wild dogs. And so just very quickly, what do we know about this parasite? Well, they create a disease that's called neosporosis, and really neosporosis is a leading cause of spontaneous abortions in cattle worldwide. And in Australia, we know that neosporosis causes substantial economic and social impact on beef and dairy industries. And to give you an example, it's estimated that every year in Australia, the cost of livestock industry due to neosporosis can go up to $110 million every year. So that's really considerable. What do we know about the life cycle of this parasite? Well, there's actually a lot of gaps. And what we do know from studies in North America is that the sylvatic cycle in North America has implicated coyotes and wolves when they consume infected herbivores like deer and cattle. So that really has suggested that in Australia, perhaps there could be a parallel life cycle between wild dogs and macropods. But this is very hypothetical. And really one of the few pieces of evidence of implicating wild dogs in this infection is the paper that I was talking to you about a minute ago, where really wild dogs have been infected in a control setting with infective bovine tissue. And the authors of this paper have observed that these dingoes were capable of shedding infective oocysts. So that really brings me to the aim of this particular project that I'm talking to you about today, where what we wanted to do was to determine the prevalence of N. caninum shedding in Australian wild dogs in the wild, not in an experimental controlled setting, and doing that by performing molecular analysis of fecal samples. So let me give you the brief outline of the project and what I'm going to be talking to you about today. So I'll tell you how we did the sample and where we did it. I'll tell you how we've managed to identify the host species of our samples. I will talk to you about our efforts into identifying the parasite load and different species of parasites in the samples. That's really the crux of what we do in the lab. And then I'll talk to you, because the talk today is focused on the Neospora, I will tell you about the phylogenetic analysis that we did with the sequences we identified. So we decided to start with fecal sample collection because they were easy to do, and in a short amount of time, we could actually have access to a number of samples. And we decided to use scat detection dogs for that. So this is just to show you some of the samples that we had. That we had the specific GPS location of the samples. They were bagged individually, and upon arrival in the lab, we froze them almost straight away. We collected the samples in November 2018, and that the rationale for this date was because between 2016 and 2018, there have been a number of reports of wild dog attacks on livestock, and so we collected the samples at this time to try and capture, I suppose, the infections in wild dogs in those areas at this time. Sorry, I can hear actually some background noise. It's not coming from me, so I'm not sure if we can mute that, but... So the locations of the samples, we really went into two different locations in rural Victoria, in Mansfield and Swifts Creek. And again, that's because those are the areas where those attacks on livestock had been reported. And over a couple of days, we managed to collect 115 samples. So 82 samples from Mansfield and 33 samples from Swifts Creek. So I told you we collected these fecal samples from the ground using dogs. So, of course, we needed to make sure the provenance of the samples. And so the first thing that we did was to identify the host species. Excuse me. And we did that by doing a qPCR analysis. So, of course, we had to extract the total genomic DNA from these samples. And then we performed some qPCR on the 118 samples. And we did that by using specific primers for fox, cat, and dog, whose sequence are indicated here, and they were previously published. As a result of the analysis, we were able to confirm a positive ID on 96% of the samples, and we actually identified that 50 of our samples were of fox origin and 60 of our samples were of dog origin. And I should point out that none of the samples that generated a product for dogs generated a product for foxes, nor vice versa. So we're pretty confident on the identification. It was interesting to note that six of the samples that were identified as dog, they also produce an amplicon for cat primers. That's probably due to dietary origin. We went on to dingo purity analysis, and I don't have the time to go into a lot of details about this analysis. It was based on previous publications and microsatellite analysis. I will summarize, though, and tell you that among the 60 dog samples that we had, we selected 28, and that had to do with the CT value of the qPCR, so that we were confident on the dingo purity analysis. And we analyzed by PCR 23 microsatellite markers. And so the data that we had is presented as such. And the way to read this is that, so in the upper part, we have the Mansfield samples, the Swifts Creek samples at the bottom. And basically what you have here is the purity level of dingo. And so you can see that we had one sample that was considered to be pure dingo. And then the other 18 samples were considered to be to various degrees of dingo purity, meaning that they were dog-dingo hybrid. And that's perhaps not surprising. So overall, out of these 28 samples, we were able to identify they belong to 19 different individuals. So, I mean that we sampled samples that belong to the same individuals. And we identified one pure dingo sample and the other one belonged to dog or dog hybrid animals. Once we were confident on the origin, animal origin, sorry, of our samples, we moved on to the parasite identification. And we decided to do a genetic analysis to identify coccidia parasites. It's a group of parasites to which Neospora belonged to. And again, we've performed in our lab this time the genomic DNA extraction using a different method. And we decided to start by amplifying very conserved gene, so the subunit 18 of the ribosomal RNA gene. And we did this by PCR. We based our analysis on conserved primers that had been previously published. And again, we screened 118 samples with these primers on that hybridized or recognized the 18S ribosomal RNA gene of coccidia parasites. They produced an amplicon of 400 base pairs, and by Sanger sequencing, we were able to identify the sequence of these positive samples. So overall, out of the 115 samples, we had 41 PCR positive coccidia samples. We did the sequencing of all of those 41. We actually had quite a range of parasites that were identified, including Cytoisospora, Sarcosis, Ammonia, and of course Neospora. And for today's purpose, I will only focus on the Neospora positive samples, but we have been identifying the other ones, and that might be a story for another time. So once we've done this genetic screen for coccidia parasites, we wanted to make sure that the Neospora samples were indeed Neospora. We wanted to get better quality of samples. So what we did then, we performed the PCR screen again on the NC5 gene. Conserved primates have been previously published to amplify this NC5 Neospora caninum gene. It produced an amplicon of 350 base pairs, and again, we did Sanger sequencing. So when we screened the 41 positive samples for coccidia, we actually had PCR positive 3N caninum samples. But the sequence, again, wasn't really 100% to our liking. And so we performed two additional PCR screens that I'll run to you rather briefly. So this is summarizing out of the 115 samples, we had 41 hits for coccidia, and three of them were positive for Neospora. When we had an NC5 screen, among the 41 positive coccidia screens, we had three that were positive. And then we did a nested PCR on another conserved gene, ITS1, that is just sitting next to the 18S gene on the same locus. And we had one positive out of these three for this PCR. And we performed again another PCR on a different part of the 18S gene. And again, we had one positive. So to summarize all these PCR screens and with sequencing analysis, we were pretty confident that sample WDG434 that belonged to a dog and collected in Mansfield was positive for N caninum. With that, we were able to calculate the prevalence of N caninum infections with the samples that we had collected. And the way to read this table is actually at the bottom, we summarize the data of the samples that were identified as fox, and we're going to be focusing on the samples that were identified as wild dogs. And because we did host analyses, we're able to calculate this prevalence based on individuals rather than number of samples, because I just told you before, we actually had collected samples that belonged to the same individuals. So it's much more accurate to have that data, because you know that you're actually looking at different individuals and not samples that can belong to the same individuals, if that makes sense. And we were able to then calculate that on our study, 60.7% of wild dogs were actively shedding N caninum oocysts at the Mansfield site the time of collection. So I told you that we had a sequence from Neospora. We had one sample we thought was positive, but we really confirmed that the best way to do it is to perform phylogenetic analysis. And so the way to go about it is that first we retrieved several gene bank sequences, either from ITS genes or 18S genes, for really a plethora of coccidia parasites. And so these sequences are available. What we wanted to do was to compare the sequence that we had obtained in our sample to all these coccidia sequences that are available, either for the ATS1 or the 18S RNA gene sequence. And so by doing that, we perform these two different analyses, either a neighboring joining analysis or a Bayesian analysis for the 18S sequence. And you have in red in here our sample. And in both cases, it really comes close with the gene bank Neospora caninum sequence with bootstraps either 97 or 67, which really gives us confidence on our data analysis. And we've done the same thing with a different gene sequence just to be sure that what we were seeing was a true result. And we actually obtained the same thing. So that our sample comes really next to the Neospora caninum sample with both analyses, either the Bayesian or the neighbor joining analysis. So in conclusion, I've shown you today that we managed to collect 115 fecal samples from regional Victoria. On the host species identifications, after performing this genetic analysis, we've identified that those samples belong to 50 foxes and 60 dogs, of which among the dog samples, we identified 19 individuals, including one pure dingo. On the parasite molecular detection, I told you to identify the number of parasites. We focus on Neospora today. Identified 41 coccidia positive samples out of the 115 and with one Neospora sample, which led us to conclude at a 6.7% prevalence in Mansfield among the samples that we've analyzed. And when we perform our Neospora phylogenetic analysis, we're pretty confident that they belong to N caninum parasites. So With that, I would like to finish by acknowledging all the number of people that contribute to this work. And I mentioned previously very talented students in my lab, Michaela Davidson, Jose Waman, and Hannah Edwards, who did an internship and was very helpful in handling the samples. Carlo at the Arthur Riley Institute, who really brought wildlife projects to our lab. Danielle Stevens from Zoological Genetics and Yvette Hitchin from Helix Molecular Solutions. They really did all the host analyses that I've shown you. Luke Woodford and all the staff of Canidae, they were absolutely instrumental and fantastic to work with. They did all the sample collection, and various collaborators throughout the country who provided different parasite DNA that we could use as controls in our study. And of course, last but not least, our generous funders, particularly including Victoria State Government. So thank you very much for your attention.